You can see my slides. Can you briefly confirm this?
Yes.
No, wait.
Both.
So you can see my slides?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, my name is Jan Schulthess. I'm working at the Norwegian University of Science and Technology. I would like to talk a little bit about how we use dark field X-ray microscopy in order to map nano twin domain variants in the bulk of ferroelectric and ferroelastic materials. I would like to start my talk with this image, which kind of explains our idea how to utilize dark field microscopy. And here you can see kind of the slice of a grain of a polycrystalline barium titanate based material, which has nano twin domain variants. And here you can see kind of the reciprocal space maps which we got out of dark field microscopy. And while this is just a beautiful image for the moment, I hope it will get more clear during the talk how we use dark field X-ray microscopy and why such techniques are important for the community of ferroelectric materials. The outline of my talk will be as follow. First, I would like to give you a brief motivation on bulk microscopy techniques and why they are important to study ferroelectric materials. Then I would like to talk a little bit about dark field X-ray microscopy and how we particularly use it to map nano twin domain variants in our ferroelectric, ferroelastic materials. And then I would show you our complex oxide, which is a model system for ferroelectric materials, and which is, as I said, this barium titanate material. And I would like to present you some data on this. So let's start a little bit with a broad introduction on the elastomorphological correlations. And when I talk about elastomorphological correlations, I kind of mean the interplay between the elastic energy or the elastic stress and the domain size or the size of the twins of the twin domains. Pikes, but particularly also multiferroic materials. And I mean, this is the area which I'm working in. And here I would like to particularly focus on the ferroelectric, ferroelastic materials. Just to give you a brief example of our community where such techniques are important, I've picked out this recent story on a complex material, which is the sodium bismuth titanate material. And this is an industrial promising material for ferroelectric or piezoelectric application because it has a high piezoelectric performance. But a drawback of this material is that the working temperature is pretty low. So now people came to the idea to put some zinc oxide inclusions into this material. And they found that with putting these zinc oxide inclusions into this material, you could increase the working temperature from about 100 degree to about 140 degree. And then some theory was developed around this, and it was kind of found that stress fields in the vicinity of these zinc oxide inclusions develop, and these stress fields induce nanoscale domain variants in the otherwise Relaxo-like matrix. Well, this already goes quite deep into the field of ferroelectric or ferroelastic materials. I think the general message here is that the interplay between the mechanical stresses and the nanoscale domain variants is important for these kind of materials. However, not only the elastomorphological correlations are important, but the second point which we need to address here is that there's a tremendous difference if we use surface-based characterization techniques or bulk-based characterization techniques. It was already known since the 1960s when people have looked at ferroelectric barium titanate single crystals that the surface of the material shows completely different optical properties compared to the inside of the material. I think here you can also nicely see it when you use a beam with a different energy, meaning a different penetration depth, you get a completely different diffraction pattern, indicating that the crystal structure at the surface is different compared to the crystal structure at the bulk. And I mean, this can be nicely understood if we consider the stress state, and the stress state at the surface is biaxial, while the stress state in the bulk is triaxial. And of course, when we want to utilize our materials for bulk application, we are interested in the triaxial stress state. And therefore, characterization techniques are required, which are then really sensitive for this triaxial stress state. And of course, I mean, here, X-ray-based characterization techniques are important. And then let's have a little bit look at the state of the art about these bulk, about these multi-scale bulk characterization techniques and what was done on ferroelectric materials so far. And I guess it's quite well known that you can use three-dimensional X-ray diffraction in order to get a full map of the grains in a ferroelectric ferroelastic material. Here we can see, for example, a barium titanate material with its individual grains with millimeter size length over millimeter length scales. And as Hugh has already shown in his talk before, the strain fields or the mosaicity scans can be utilized in order to visualize ferroelectric or ferroelastic domains for domain sizes which are in the micrometer range. However, of course, most of the application relevant materials in the ferroelectric ferroelastic community, as I've shown you on a couple of slides before, can be found here. And of course, then the question arises, how can we utilize bulk diffraction techniques in order to get sub 100 nanometer resolution? And the goal of my talk today, or the goal of the work that I did with dark field X-ray microscopy, is kind of to fill this gap. So the aim of my talk today is to present you how we utilize dark field X-ray microscopy in order to map and quantify the elastomorphological correlations in the bulk of a ferroelectric material with nanoscale resolutions. I guess you are aware of the advantages of dark field X-ray microscopy, so I do not want to go too much into details into here. And in the end of my talk, I would like to also show you some approaches how we used dark field X-ray microscopy for in situ studies. So let's have a look at our model system. As Hugh already introduced, barium titanate is still the most applied or most known material. Here we are using a slight modification of a barium titanate by putting calcium on the A place and titanium on the B place. Here you can see the complex phase diagram. I do not want to go too much into details here today. Just the message is that the complex phase diagram kind of is represented then in the microstructure of the material. And when we go somewhere in this this area where phase coexistence exists, we get very complex microstructures. And here you can particularly see some transmission electron microscopy or some piezo response force microscopy images. And I particularly would like to point out that we get nano twin domain variants inside these materials. And the question is now, of course, how we can map and quantify these nanoscale domain variants in the bulk. As I've already pointed out, we are using dark field X-ray microscopy to do this. I guess the concept is familiar to most of you. We have an incident beam, and this incident beam can be kind of used to pick out one individual grain of our polycrystalline material. And then we kind of use an objective lens in order to zoom in into the individual features. Now, what we kind of the raw data that we get out are strain and reciprocal space maps. And we get kind of each of these maps for each of the embedded subvolumes inside the bulk. Now here you can see the reciprocal space maps from the nanoscale subvolumes. Now when we average the reciprocal space maps over the entire cross section of our grain, we get a reciprocal space maps which we get a macroscopically averaged reciprocal space maps which looks something like this. So basically what we get is one bump in the middle of this reciprocal space maps space map, and then this gives us the impression of a very homogeneous material. Now, when we zoom in into an individual nanoscale subvolume, so here you can kind of see now a representative reciprocal space map of one of these nanoscale subvolumes, you can see that the impression which you get from the macroscopically averaged reciprocal space map is not entirely correct, because here clearly separated individual diffraction peaks can be identified. And now kind of what we did was to develop a MATLAB-based script, and which kind of then identifies each of these reciprocal, which then kind of identifies each of these peaks in the reciprocal space maps. And then for each nanoscale subvolume, this affords us to quantify the density of the domain variance just by calculating the amount of diffraction peaks and divided by the nanoscale subvolume. So now doing this not only for one nanoscale subvolume, but for about 60,000 subvolumes, we get the image which I've already shown you in the beginning. So now we can go a little bit more into details here. So what we see is the density of the domain variance. Now, red areas correspond to high density of domain variance, while yellow areas correspond to small density of the domain variance. And here you can see the representative reciprocal space maps with 15, 7, or 1 diffraction peaks. And we also estimated the size of the nanoscale domain variance as 50, 75, or 200 nanometer, clearly showing that the resolution is in the sub 100 nanometer range. Now, I mean, it's worth to mention here that we estimate the size of the nanoscale domain variance. Of course, the size of the twin domains can be much, much, much smaller, but this is not, but this we cannot resolve here. So now after I've introduced our methodology or our idea how to utilize the reciprocal space maps obtained from dark field X-ray microscopy, I would like to talk a little bit about the material science background and why this is interesting for our community. Therefore, here you can see again the density of the domain variance in the cross section of the grain. And now simultaneously we map the elastic stress and the elastic strain energy. And now out of these images, we can draw some conclusions. For example, we can estimate the impact of the grain boundary. And now here I plot the elastic strain energy and the density of the domain variance as a function of the distance from the grain boundary. So basically the grain boundary is sitting here, while here we are in the center of our grain. And we can see that the elastic energy is decreasing, which comes along with a decrease of the density of the domain variance. Now this is different compared to previous results which have been shown here, because now this really represents the triaxial stress state in the bulk. And as I've pointed out in the beginning, this is important because the properties at the surface and at the bulk might be fundamentally different. The last question which we addressed using our methodology is the impact of the electric field. Now, as you might know, the development of the polarization or the strain loop is a fundamental property of ferroelectric and ferroelastic materials. Now here, in order to visualize what we are doing, I've measured a polarization hysteresis loop under a unipolar electric field going up to 4 kV/mm. And here you can see that this loop nicely saturates, and we have then recorded dark field X-ray microscopy images at position 1, 2, 3, and 4. And here you can see the density of the domain variance, and here you can see the elastic properties which were measured simultaneously. And particularly, I would like to draw your attention to the comparison of the virgin state and the highest electric field, which is about 10 times the coercive field. And you can nicely see that with increasing the electric field, the material gets much more homogeneous. However, in addition to this image, we can now also quantify the electric field dependent effect. And particularly here, you can see the elastic energy plotted as a function of the electric field, and the density of the domain variance plotted as a function of the electric field. And you can see that both of these parameters decrease by about 40 to 50%. And I mean, this was interesting for our research because this nicely correlates with the change of the macroscopic piezoelectric coefficient of this material, which also decreased by about 40% when you increase the electric field. And this indicates the importance of the nanotwin domain variance for the piezoelectric performance of this material. In addition, we can now visualize or quantify the impact of the electric field on the stress distributions. And while the stress distributions are broad in the virgin state, they kind of sharpen with increasing the electric field, indicating that our grain gets a more single crystalline character. So at the end of my talk, I hope I could show you that there's an interplay between the elastomorphological correlation and the functional properties. And this interplay in the bulk is determined by the triaxial stress state. And I've shown you a methodology how to use dark field X-ray microscopy in order to visualize and to quantify the nanoscale domain variance in the bulk of a grain of a model ferroelectric ferroelastic material. And I would like to point out that this technique is not only applied to ferroelectric materials, but it is applicable to all twinned materials with nanoscale domain sizes. So if you have any questions, I'm always happy to receive them via mail, or you can ask them now immediately. And I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Jan, for a very nice presentation. I don't see any immediate questions. You mentioned that potentially there is a big difference between the bulk and what is observed in the surface. How does the data that you've measured in the bulk match up to the surface measurements?
This is a good question. I mean in quantitative way, I mean, one can see, of course, that there's a correlation between the surface and the bulk data. I mean, using surface sensitive techniques, one can, for example, also see that the domain size in the vicinity of the grain boundary is smaller compared to the bulk of the material. However, I think the advantage of dark field X-ray microscopy is now that we can put some quantitative values here, which I guess is not so easy using surface sensitive techniques. But I mean, in a qualitative way, the surface sensitive techniques and the bulk techniques agree, which is of course a good sign. But I guess the advantage is that we can now put values
here. Now you're sure, yes. Yeah. Henning has a question.
Yes, sorry, I'm seemingly too stupid to figure out how to use the question and answer. But nevertheless, Jan, thank you for this very illuminating talk. And I have this general question. I mean, you are interested in the correlation between elastic properties and these nanoscale correlations, structures. Now, with dark field X-ray microscopy, at best, we can measure three strain components if we have one reflection. So is that a limitation for you? I mean, in your work,
that you can only measure three strain components. This is what you mean.
Yes.
I guess measuring three components is of course better than measuring non-strain component. I mean, I think what we did here is that we just looked at one strain component and we just looked at one diffraction peak, which is the 111 peak. But I mean, we didn't go deeper in looking at the other strain components. And I mean, I would not say that this is a limitation, but I guess I need to think a little bit more about how many strain components are really required in order to figure out these elastomorphological correlations. But I guess this is a question which is also strongly material dependent and which will be dependent then, for example, on the crystal structure of our material. But I mean, as I said, I didn't think so far about it yet, but I guess, I mean, this needs to be considered, I guess, for the future as well.
Yes, because you motivate this by the fact that in the bulk, you have a triaxial stress state, and this will of course be heterogeneous. So I just imagine that if you had a way in which you could actually determine this triaxial state, then that would be more ideal.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
I think we've lost Carsten. He's muted, perhaps.
No, I'm muted. I'm sorry. Mats, you have a question?
Oh yeah, I wanted to ask a quick question. So in these materials with nanometer size domains, there is this famous average diffraction effect, where when the size of the domains goes below some certain size, you no longer see the local structure, but you see some coherently averaged structure. So kind of the disappearance of several peaks into one central peak is not necessarily a effect of the structure becoming more single crystal-like. It could also be an effect of the domains becoming smaller. Do you have a way of knowing which is the case?
I think what you're asking goes in the direction how the strains field in the vicinity of the domain walls impact the overall diffraction. And I guess what Hugh is showing here that there's really strains field in the vicinity of the domain walls. But I mean, as far as I would say for our diffraction data, I mean, we can still clearly separate the individual diffraction peaks, which gives me confidence that what we really see are strains coming from individual domain variants. But I guess, I mean...
Yes, but the ones I'm thinking about is when you only see one central peak, I think on your next slide, maybe. Here, that's much broader than the single peaks you see in the other reciprocal space maps here. So if this really was an area where the structure was more ordered, I would have expected a narrower peak.
Yeah, I guess this is a good point, and I also thought about it. But I mean, I think what gives me confidence is that we really see a more ordered structure here. Is that we see a nice correlation between the elastic properties and the size of the domain variance. And in addition, we also see the electric field effects, and this I mean. Which is kind of expected that when you increase the electric field, the size of the domains gets larger. I mean, I think this kind of corroborates the methodology that we are using, but I guess it's of course true that there's much more information hidden in these reciprocal space maps, and which we do not consider just using the peak function that we have developed. And I guess the broadness of the peak would be an additional parameter which could be looked at. I mean, but I guess your comment is true, and I was also wondering why the peaks appear broad while those appear much more sharp.
Thanks,
Mats. If I can add something, I guess the question you are asking it's also referred to adaptive phase X-ray diffraction, where you have diffraction from nano domains. And there is a kind of coherent system of domains. And indeed, instead of two peaks, you see a peak in the middle, right? I'm not sure something can be done with this, because in this case, domains are really smaller than 10 nanometers. And what you see is a sort of a macroscopic averaging of these domains.
Okay. I think that remains an open question that will have to be studied in a bit more detail than what we can do online here now. So thank you again, Jan. And since Sam is already